So these are the tests that are included in the IDEL diagnostics. Apart from taking a detailed health history, we do the VIGO, the Detarellis testing, for determining all that that was on the list that I mentioned prior. We do autonomic response testing. You can measure all sorts of things with ART. If you ever get a chance to go to a weekend workshop of Dr. Klinhart, which I think he does hold them here in the UK occasionally, well, it's very worthwhile doing. It's an eye-opener. And, you know, it's quite easy to learn these techniques and apply them very successfully for determining many things that if you don't have the tools to do, you don't know. And if you don't know, you can't treat. We do thermography as well. Thermography is not a test of anatomy. It's a test of physiology. The MRI scans, the CAT scans, the X-rays, these are tests of anatomy because they're looking at structure. Is it big? Is it small? Does it have a cyst, etc.? Here, we are looking at the temperature differentials of the skin, which are part of the autonomic nervous system, which connect to all the organ systems. So where you have an inflammation somewhere in the body, it will bring up a hypothermia. It will show it as red, basically, on your screen. Now, I send all these images to MD thermologists, and they write diagnostic reports, because I don't want to get into the politics of, you know, interpreting all that. And that service is available to anybody to simply send the images and get them interpreted. Iridology, it's a very simple tool to elicit a lot of health information, you know, very quickly. 5 minutes, 6 minutes, doesn't take a lot. Live blood analysis, and then, you know, we can do, we do the BTA, the tissue hair mineral analysis, the Indicans tests, you know, for gut toxicity. Metabolic typing, you probably are familiar with Bill Walcott's work, you know, metabolic typing, because everybody has their own individual metabolic type. And this is programmed from birth in our genes to determine the percentage of proteins, the percentage of fats, the percentage of carbohydrates that our body needs. Now, some of my sickest patients are vegetarians because they have consciously or unconsciously, or the, you know, cosmos have sent them messages to make that decision. But if they're a protein type and they need 40% protein on each plate and 30% carbohydrates, 30% fat, and this is what I am. And when I tried to become a vegetarian a few years ago, I wrote about it in the first chapter of my book. I was as sick as a dog. I couldn't understand. I had muscle wasting. My cholesterol level shot up. You know, even though I'd reduced my protein intake to about 10%, I was eating all these fresh vegetables and fruit and seeds and things. I lost the clarity of mind. My energy levels dropped. I mean, I was as sick as a dog until a friend of mine came in who knew about metabolic typing, took one look at me and said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm eating all these healthy things." "Yes," he said, "but, you know, what is your metabolic type?" When I found out that I was indeed a protein type and went onto the ratio, because it's the octane of fuel, that ratio, that 40-30-30 in my particular case was my octane of fuel, controls 9 parameters of our internal biochemistry. We'll mention them briefly when we come to that part. I think we need to take a small break so we can get some water, and we'll carry on after that.
Thank you very much, George. Before we break, we have a few minutes for questions, although there will be a part two from 11:30 till 12:45, where George may already plan to answer some of those questions. If anybody's got any questions on... I'll repeat it for you.
Question about the protein intake, because that's something that has interested me a lot as well, and I've written a number of books on natural health, and one of them I set out to find out how much protein as a percentage of calories there are in lots of in about 600 different foods, and the result was very surprising, because most vegetables, for example, leaves and beans and pulses and so on,
contain protein.
Have got at least 40%, some of them 60% protein. So it's not impossible to get 40% protein as a vegetarian or a vegan.
Yes, but you have to eat huge amounts. I mean, you may be referring to things like the Gershon diet, for example, where you know they're drinking lots of carrot juices and eating organic fruits and vegetables, etc. But because of the quantity that they're eating, because they eat kilos per day.
No, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about what you eat to satisfy your calorie need.
Who are we talking about?
Anyone.
No, that's not true, because
anyone. No, just let me finish. Anyone who eats has to eat a certain number of calories to survive. You agree on that? Yeah. And it's the percentage of calories as either that can either be protein, fat, or carbohydrate. But since many vegetables or vegetable foods, whether they're pulses or green leaves in particular, contain more than 40% of their inherent calories as protein, it is actually not impossible at all to eat the 40% of protein as a vegetarian or a vegan, because it depends on what else you eat. And in fact, the
Can I just stop you?
Thing I found in that was that many meats contain less than 40% protein, because they contain a lot of fat.
The point is taken. I strongly suggest you read Metabolic Typing by Bill Walcott, and also Western Price's work. And you know, that may give you a different perspective on things, because it is true that if you are a protein type according to your metabolic type, which can be measured, of course, and you decide to become a vegetarian, irrelevant of the percentage of calories as proteins in the vegetarian diet, you will become ill, because you are upsetting the metabolism of protein, the metabolism of carbohydrates, the metabolism of fats, your energy pathways, your detoxification pathways. We said there's 9 parameters of your internal biochemistry that are upset if you don't take the correct octane. And this is not relevant to everybody. You know, there are other diets, like the Sears diet, which is, you know, they say 30, 30, 40 for everybody. Well, this is not the case, because there are some people that are 65% carbohydrates and only 15% protein. They will not do well on the Atkins diet, for example, which is, you know, heavily loaded in protein. A protein type would do really well on an Atkins diet. So we cannot generalize this to everybody. This is where we disagree, because you're talking about this applying to everybody, and I'm saying, well, okay, I don't want to enter. I think we will allow you know, other questions at this point.
Yeah, let's try and keep the questions brief. Thank you very much. It's an age-old question. Is it possible to get enough protein from a vegetarian diet? And there are obviously differing opinions, so let's leave it at that for now. Yes, another question.
Could you please explain what live blood analysis is?
What is live blood analysis? Could you explain more, George?
It's using a dark field microscope with a carotid condenser, whereby you're staining the drop of live blood that you have with light. So you're not using chemicals to kill it. So you can actually see living blood, and if you see it, it's very spectacular because you've got all these little proteids moving around, which are colloidal pieces of protein. You've got white blood cells, the neutrophils, for example, you know, that are phagocytic and they move around. So you're actually looking at the quality of the immune system. You know, if I look at the blood of cancer patients, for example, yeah, they've got plenty of white blood cells, but they're all static. They're non-viable. They're not moving. You know, the immune system is too stressed. You can also elicit a lot of other information from that. It's a qualitative analysis. Even though there are things that are common to classical microbiologists, and in the course that I've written on live blood analysis, you know, on the Da Vinci College of Holistic Medicine, I differentiate between the classical microbiological view, which is important because, you know, if you say things to patients and you're in a court of law, you need to be able, and they brought in three microbiologists, you need to be able to talk their language as well. But I've also presented the Enderline, Professor Enderline, who was the father of live blood analysis. He was the one, you know, who developed what are known as the Sanum remedies now, the isopathic remedies.
Yeah. Testing, and I always question how do we get 20,000
on the 20th of November. I've got a group of practitioners from around the world, and I'll be doing a 5-day intensive in clinical in bioresonance testing. When I start the lecture, I bring in my bouzouki. It's a musical instrument that I play, and I play the bouzouki. You know, I give them a couple of tunes, you know. And then I hand the bouzouki to each of them. And I say, you play. And of course, they can't even find the chords. And I use that analogy to say that the Vega machine, or the bioresonance device, is very accurate, but the therapist needs to be trained to become accurate. The machine itself is measuring galvanic skin response from acupoints. So therefore, it's as accurate as any other machine. You know, it's electronic circuitry. Doesn't give you the wrong information. It's measuring a resonance phenomena. However, it does require the therapist to be able to resonate with that device in the same way as I resonate now with my bouzouki. You know, how do you see a guitar player, let's say, you know, who plays the guitar so effortlessly, and then someone else tries to play the guitar, and you know, you want to...
That's a great analogy. I'm not adverse to that. What I'm interested in is if you took that guitar and that bouzouki, translated it into music, and gave it to another bouzouki player, they could play the same tune. What I'm interested to know is you know, from the manufacturer, the ego, of your experience, what is the reverse overlap between bioresonance testing and other acceptable functions?
Okay. Okay, well, firstly, the type of testing you're talking about is measuring clinical changes. So therefore, there are often subclinical changes that are not measured on functional tests. So the functional test will not be able to show you those, of course. And you can have patients that are sick as dogs or cats or whatever. But they have a lot of subclinical etiologies. The bioresonance testing is measuring those subclinical, but also the clinical. So if they do have clinical symptoms on the functional test, you will also be able to find them on the Vega or on the bioresonance device that you're using. But if they do not have the clinical, you know, manifestations on the functional test, that doesn't necessarily mean that you will not find something on the bioresonance testing that is indicating an underlying, you know, etiological factor that may be manifesting but hasn't quite reached the clinical. So it's a spectrum, if you like. It's a spectrum. But where the bioresonance testing comes into its field is in identifying the subclinical. And the functional, we have the functional, okay, you know.
Okay, thank you very much for the questions. There will be chance for questions at the end as well, but we're on a tight schedule. We've got 15 minutes for a quick coffee and refreshment break.
Regarding your interest in Hellinger family constellations, because it is something that will actually help in your own spiritual development as practitioners. If there are enough people interested, because I am a qualified practitioner, if you like, of Hellinger, if there's people interested, enough people, I mean, we probably need about a dozen to really, you know, have a good group. And it would have to be over a whole weekend. It's not enough to do 12 people in one day. You can do a maximum of maybe six in a day. If there's 12, we could do it over a weekend. I'm just throwing that out. If you're interested in setting that up and organizing it, then... Okay. It's a mind-blowing experience. It really is. I don't even want to get into explaining the logistics of it, because it's experiential. You know, it's something you have to be there to experience. Even when they tried to explain it to me before I went to the first constellation, I didn't really understand it, you know. But when I was there, then I really understood it, you know, because you're there. Whether you do your constellation or you don't do your constellation, you will benefit therapeutically from other people's constellations as well. And this is spiritual work. It's nothing to do with psychotherapy. It's not psychotherapy. It works in a spiritual field, a bit like Sheldrake's work, you know, the field. You open up a spiritual field, and everything works in that spiritual field, and there are mysteries in that spiritual field that, you know, has your hair standing on end. But very, very beautiful mysteries about, you know, the heart, and how the heart, you know, is wanting to open up, and that is the intention. Plus overcoming some of the systemic entanglements that we all have as part of our fate. So, where were we? Okay, now I have developed what I call the Da Vinci Universal Treatment Protocols, because I have a lot of international clients coming in that are quite sick, and they're only there for a week, let's say. As soon as they arrive Monday morning, then we do the IDEL Diagnostics, which is a five-hour testing protocol, and then we elicit probably 80% of the information from the IDEL Diagnostics that we can then input into the Da Vinci Universal Treatment Protocols. Now, this is a circuit of different therapies using some technologies as well, that takes about 4 hours to complete. So the patient basically comes in every day and does the treatments as well. So we you know, focus on different levels of detoxification. We do an alkali detoxification diet. Those that have bought the book, you will see that is written in there. It's a 2-week fruit and vegetable diet, you know, to help bring the pH of the body tissues back to some sort of normality, to help remove some of these inflammatory chemicals that have been accumulated over the years. I often say to patients, you know, if they're 50 years old, if you didn't clean your house for 50 years, you know, what would be missing? Rats, mice, you know, beetles, all sorts. It's the same with the body. You know, we need to clean our body every 6 months, I say. Every 6 months. I have been doing this for 20 years now. Every 6 months, I do 2 weeks fruit and veg with some juicing. You know, carrot as a base maybe, you know, and then we'll add some greens in there, maybe a beetroot, that sort of thing that I think a lot of you are familiar with, you know, as part of naturopathic protocols. Then we can do parasite cleansing, either using the Holder-Clark protocol with the wormwood, the cloves, and the walnut tincture. It works okay for some of the helminths and the nematodes. I wouldn't say it works particularly well for protozoa, amoebas, and that sort of thing. It doesn't work for Tinea, our friend the tapeworm. That is a tough one. But, you know, patients that are also interested in taking back these devices, once we've identified specifically using VRT testing, bioresonance testing, the specific parasites, protozoa, bacteria, viruses, etc., we can program them on here, and then the patient takes this back with them and runs it, basically. You know, so they just simply turn it on, and there's the antenna is at the back, and basically, you know, they wear it on their bodies, they put it in their pocket, they put it on their belt, you know, around their necks. And believe me, in the year and a half that I've been using these, for the first time in 30 years, I've managed to eradicate herpes, I've managed to eradicate HPV, hepatitis A. I haven't got round to the B and C yet, for logistical reasons, but the Russians have. The Russians have actually eradicated hepatitis B and C using bioresonance alone. And they have, you know, clinical studies on this. Cleaning the liver, you know, with I don't know what protocol you call it, the Moritz protocol, or the, you know, the olive oil with the citrus juice, and using Epsom salts to magnesium sulfate to open up the gallbladder ducts. This is important. And also using malic acid or magnesium malate as capsules, or malic acid from apple juice to soften the stones. I have a whole archive full of images of gallbladder cleanses where people have been saved from the scalpel, from scalpel happy surgeons. Toxic metals, we'll come to the HMD, we'll talk about that. Matrix regeneration therapy, ozone and infrared sauna, colon hydrotherapy, we do all of these. So it's all part of the circuit where they go into an ozone sauna, so, you know, the skin pores open up, but now they're getting the benefit of the oxygenation as well from the ozone. We can also give them some ozonated water and ozonated olive oil. The olive oil is a bit more problematical because it takes a minimum of 3 weeks to make ozonated olive oil. So you've got to have your ozone generator running for 3 weeks minimum in order to lock in the, but olive oil is, ozonated olive oil, or medical olive oil as it's called, is a beautiful substance for dealing with, you know, wounds, open wounds, it has, because it's locking in the ozone, and it will do that for many months, whereas water, it will dissipate very quickly. So you can ozonate a glass of water for half an hour, but they have to drink it immediately. They still get the benefits. And then we sujok acupuncture. I don't know if you're aware of the Korean type of acupuncture. Su stands for hand, jok is for foot. We have a whole clinic on our hands and our foot. You know, it's a correspondence system akin to reflexology. And interestingly, you know, here are the arms. Here are the legs. This is the body. This is the chest. This is the neck. This is the head. So, if you stimulate, you know, the thumb, for example, which corresponds to the head, when you've got a headache, you'll probably find that within a few minutes it will disappear. It's the most powerful form of therapy that I have studied for pain conditions. I haven't met any other type of therapy that has the same power for alleviating pain conditions. And you work directly from the hand. It's so easy. We talked about the soft laser. We can do bioresonance therapy as opposed to diagnosis. I don't know. Well, we'll come to that. There's Rife bioresonance. There's the Lakovsky multi-wave oscillator. These are all electromagnetic therapeutic devices that have been around for a number of years. Microcurrent therapy, orgone accumulator, you know, from Dr. Wilhelm Reif's work. The PAPIMI is a very powerful pulsing electromagnetic device which has tremendous healing potential because it increases the transmembrane potential of the tissues and the cells. So it can eradicate uterine myomas, polycystic ovaries. We've got rid of tumors. All sorts of things. I did a TV program on the national TV about electromedicine, and one of the things the TV crew came to the center and they took the PAPIMI, and I was inundated with sort of elderly women, mostly, you know, average age 75, with hip problems, coming in with their, you know, little bees and things. And I would say to them, look, you know, because they all wanted to go on the PAPIMI, I would say to them, if you want to go on the PAPIMI, you do 6 treatments. It may work, it may not work. You know, if it works and you see improvement within 6 treatments, then we can discuss maybe doing a few more treatments. Within 6 treatments, I saw miracles. I really saw miracles. People that were coming in, you know, with their walking sticks, chuck their walking sticks away, and they were walking, you know, because, you know, it just got rid of all the inflammation in the hip area, etc. So it's a very powerful device. We also work with chiropractors and osteopaths. I'm not one myself. We also do, I don't know if you know of Rothbart's work, you know, proprioceptor soles, hyperpronation, body posture, you know. Well, you know, people that have, you know, the wrong body posture due to hyperpronation, which is, you know, from the soles of the feet from birth, which is very easy to measure. If you use these proprioceptor insoles, it's miraculous how their body posture just becomes normal within seconds, because it's a neural connection. There's a neural, you know, the proprioceptor receptors of the soul, you know, communicate directly with the brain, and the brain now is sending the messages back once the proprioceptors are in place to straighten the body posture, which is very important because many people will, you know, degenerate knees and lower back and or have all sorts of problems. I got into this because I had back problems. I used to, you know, be part of the national judo team when I was younger at university, and I obviously got, you know, my back beaten, you know, quite a lot, and so I, you know, developed low back pain. I was going to chiropractors every couple of months, and you know, it helped a bit, and then I was going back out, and I thought, well, wait a minute, there must be underlying causative factors, and this is where I got into this, because the body posture is one of the underlying causes of low back problems. Again, encouragement for the osteopaths to get into Rothbart's work is fascinating. Okay, naturopathy, nutrition, the metabolic typing we've already talked about, herbal medicine, homeopathy. I have degrees and diplomas in all these, so, you know, I practice these. And I'm also a clinical sexologist. And developed naturopathic sexology, but we'll talk about that later. smoking cessation using a bioresonance therapy device, 95% success. 95% success. They smoke their last cigarette, they bring the butt along with the ash that goes in, because that contains all the pathological oscillatory frequencies of them and all the chemicals involved in the tobacco. And then you stick it into the bioresonance device, you invert the pathological oscillatory frequencies in order to cancel them out, and they are being treated, you know, over a 15-minute period. A lot of them go cold turkey, you know, because it literally flushes nicotine out of the body, and they literally go cold turkey that night. And then we do two follow-up treatments within a 10-day period, and that's it. And that's a 95% success. Very simple to do. You can do it on the bioresonance device that we have on the table downstairs. This is the center. This is reception, this is main office. I use the Vega as well. This is a German technology. It was invented by Schimmel, who was working with Vol. But Vol, you had to learn all the acupoints of the body. There's probably about 1,500 of them. So good Vol practitioners would be in training for 10 years. And it works beautifully. And at the time, it was a very good method for identifying all this subclinical etiology. However, Schimmel came along and said, well, wait a minute, you know, if we use one point instead of all these points, but we use ampules, you know, an ampule of a healthy liver. If you put an ampule of a healthy liver on the honeycomb here, and the person doesn't have a healthy liver, because there's a resonant frequency of the liver, then if they're not in resonance, then you will get a conductivity drop here. And that just tells you that there's a problem with the liver. Now, you can then ask, while you've got the liver on there, you can say, well, what is this? Could this be related to a virus, maybe? You know, and then you can check that out. Could it be related to a parasite? You can check that out. Could it be related to cirrhosis? Could it be related to whatever, you know? And then you can ask all these questions, and then you can go through all the organ systems. You can go through all the microbes. This is all my food testing kit. So I always do about 100 foods to identify. It's the biggest source of internal inflammation, food intolerances. It's the biggest source of internal inflammation. So if you want that person to stop taking all these inflammatory chemicals into their body, or rather the body producing the inflammatory chemicals from the trigger, because the the immune system is now producing immunoglobulins that are attaching to the food molecules for producing immune complexes, which form a trigger for the body to start producing all these cytokines, COX-2, inflammatory chemicals. Here, Grant is the answer to the question. 70% of chronic diseases have functional disturbances, which is subclinical, and that's the difference between using this type of testing and using the functional clinical tests. This is Russian technology. I've got an example of this downstairs. These are the little devices that I've showed you. This is the Therapy 8 stick, the USB with all the frequency programs on them. The Russians have done a lot of work in this area over the last 20 years. Their problem is the language. They don't speak English. Their top profs don't speak English. So because I've been in the field of bioresonance for 20 years, when I went to their lectures, they picked me out, and now I've become the English-speaking prof for all the world. It's a big responsibility. But because I love this type of work, because it really is a very important part of the holistic model, I have put courses together now. There is an online course on the college website called Energy Medicine and Bioresonance, which is the starting point for any practitioner that wants to get into the field of bioresonance, because they have to understand the theory. And then, as I mentioned, on the 20th of November, I am holding a five-day intensive clinical hands-on training to familiarize ourselves, with this type of technology. Okay, I'm not going to go into this in detail because I've already mentioned quite a lot, but with the VRT testing, the bioresonance testing, VRT, by the way, stands for vegetative reflex testing, which is what Schimmel got into when he was using one point, as opposed to the vol testing, which is using all the points of the body. There are still quite a lot of German doctors that do vol testing. Takes them 2 days to diagnose per patient, but they do it. We can look at all the organ systems. We can look at the status of the organ systems. We can look at we can go down to the cellular level. We can go down to the DNA level. We can look at biophoton indexes of different organs and tissues. We can look at emotional side. We can look at the causes. You test the prostate, there's a problem. What's the problem with the prostate? You stick a chlamydia, let's say, in there. He's got chlamydia, right. Is it prostatitis? No. Is it benign prostate hypertrophy? Yes. And you get this information in a few minutes, literally, a few minutes. How else would you get it? I don't know. This is the autonomic response testing that we spoke about previously, that Dr. Klinhart has put together. If you manage to get to a weekend, it's very worthwhile. You can test again. Pretty much what you can test on the VRT testing, you can do test with ART. You can test both. The VRT testing is going to be more efficient in identifying the causal chains, the VRT testing. But I mean, there are so many issues that you can touch on. This is the live blood analysis. It's a dark field microscope. I've got a zoom video camera. Patient sees their own blood on the screen. Beautiful visual medicine. When you find a little wormy in the blood, people are horrified, and it's amazing how the compliance increases. And before they leave, they must ask the same question 5 or 6 times: Are we going to get rid of that worm? Yes, we're going to get rid of the worm. And women particularly are horrified, and often we find 5 or 6 worms in 1 drop of blood. So you can imagine, make that into 5.5 liters and you've got a lot of worms in the body. Of course, worms also, go to the toilet. So, it's not nice for all these worms to be going to the toilet inside our bodies and causing more toxicity. Iridology. This is a beautiful science as well, because, there's a lot of recent research, looking at other aspects that haven't been, looked at in detail, like the endocrine system. John Andrews, for example, has done a lot of work in this area here in the UK. But the Russians have also done a lot of work. Unfortunately, it's still in Russian. Dr. Walter worked out how iridology actually works, whereby from all the glands, organs, and tissues, there are nerve fibers that, come up the spinal cord to the thalamus and the hypothalamus into the optic branch of the trigeminal ganglion and into the motor neurons of the iris muscular structure. Tuberculi. And so therefore, if there are changes in those organ systems, then the iris is like a little video screen that is recording those changes. The iridologist just has to know what they're looking at. And there are quite a few hundreds of markings of the iris that, each marking tells you different things. But I can look at an iris for 10 seconds, that's not an exaggeration, and I can tell where the patient has subluxations, whether it's cervical, thoracic, lumbar, sacral. I can tell whether they have hypochlorhydria problems, whether they have pancreatic deficiencies, whether where the inflammation is, in what body tissues, etc., etc. The Korean government actually did some research, and they cross-correlated the iridological findings with clinical testing, and also scanning and what have you, and these are the types of cross-correlations they found for these types of systems. Overall, the average would be an 80% accuracy. This immune system now, that because of the latest research, I would say that figure is much higher now because of the latest research. This is, fairly old. This is the matrix regeneration therapy. It's using the principle of suction, like the suction caps that are used by traditional acupuncturists mostly, and naturopaths, of course. It's got a bioresonance, there is a bioresonance current going through these little wheels that can actually detect the resonant frequencies of the toxins that are coming out of the mesenchyme and invert them. So it's cancelling out, as it's moving along the skin, the pathological oscillatory frequencies while it's pulling the toxins out, and then with a lymphatic massage, they go. It's a very powerful way of pulling toxins from deep inside the body out. It's very powerful. Biological terrain analysis is using urine, saliva, and blood, and it cross-correlates using a computer program the pH of those fluids, the redox potential, and the resistivity. There's a lot of biochemistry involved in this, but basically the pH of the blood, urine, and saliva will tell us things about the efficiency of ATP production, whether they're breathing correctly. and taking in enough oxygen. A lot of people don't. The acidosis, alkalosis balance, digestive issues, particularly with pancreas. The oxidative stress will tell us the degree of oxidative stress overall. So it pinpoints nutritional deficiencies, stress, lack of exercise, you know, where you need to focus. And the resistivity is measuring the level of minerals, kidney status, adrenals, electrolyte imbalance, and lymphatic congestion. So you can see, you know, with a simple test like this, which doesn't take my staff longer than, I don't know, 10 minutes, 15 minutes to run this test, you can pick up, you know, quite a lot of information about the internal biochemistry of the body. Heart rate variability, this is associated with aging, decreased autonomic activity, hormonal status. And for me, what this will tell me is whether the person is degenerating, if they go into the red region here, or you know, where they are on the spectrum, because this is the efficiency of functioning of all the physiological systems of the body, because it's tapping into the autonomic nervous system using different algorithms to put this information together. And the adaptability scale is how they're coping with stress, how they're coping, you know, with changes in the environment. So this is a good test overall. It's used, of course, you know, extensively by many practitioners now. Are you all familiar with a lot of this? Familiar, yeah? Okay. This is the thermography. You see, you know, all the red regions are inflammation. So it's a test of physiology, not a test of anatomy. This will give you more different information from the information that perhaps an MRI scan or a CT scan or an X-ray will give you. It's also a beautiful breast screening tool, because it is truly breast screening without the invasive component of mammography, which of course is gamma radiation. And there's a between 1% and 2% chance of developing cancer from the mammographies alone, depending on how old the equipment is. And it can also detect tumors far earlier than a mammography, because it doesn't have to grow to that size that is required for the mammography to pick up. It can be a pinpoint, but because of the angiogenesis, whereby the tumor now has pulled in the blood vessels to feed itself, it's now seeing the heat of those blood vessels. And they say you can detect up to 8 years before the mammography can detect a tumor. I am more conservative and say 2 years, which is, I think, still a big advantage. And these screening tests, you know, can be done on a yearly basis for women of all age groups, because as you're probably aware, mammography is only for the elder generation, because the younger generation, the density of breast tissue is too dense for the mammography scan to pick anything up. This can be done from any age group, and it's non-invasive. As I said, I send these images to MD thermologists, and they come back with a diagnostic report. And it's very accurate, usually. But thermography can also be used to detect heart disease, arthritis, neck and back problems, dental issues, because you get a lot of inflammation around the mouth, sinusitis, headaches, immune dysfunction, you know, carpal tunnel syndromes, bursitis, you know, cancers, etc. Breast thermography has an average sensitivity and specificity of 90%. An abnormal infrared image is the single most important marker of high risk for developing breast cancer. So this should be used more often, you know, in clinics as well. it's FDA approved as well. I think we've spent enough time talking about metabolic typing. The Da Vinci, these are the therapy protocols. This is another form of bioresonance. I think you're probably all familiar with Dr. Reif. No? Well, he may be, you know, one of the fathers of bioresonance, because back in 1934, using this universal microscope, which could actually see living viruses, because it had a magnification of about 60,000 times with a very high resolution, he invented his bioresonance devices that were much bigger than that. It was probably, you know, it would take up a whole room using the technology of those days. But he managed to find the resonant frequency of what he called the BX and the BY virus, which are pleomorphic forms that are found in all cancer cells. And he did this research time and time again, to the point where the medical committee in California, where he was working in 1934, brought him 16 terminally ill cancer patients from, you know, the back wards. They were on their way out. And within 120 days, using the frequency instrument, he had cured all of them. And this was under a medical committee of all the, you know, reputable, eminent doctors of the time. However, when the FDA got hold of this, they just moved in, they threatened, they pulled Dr. Reif out through the courts. He became very depressed. They smashed his laboratory equipment. They took his records. He actually found the mortal oscillatory rate for over 55 major bacterial diseases, including TB of the time and many others. So if you can imagine that, you know, if a little bit of money was put into this type of research back in 1934, a lot of these infectious diseases now would have been eradicated. And my dream is to do this type of research. This is me in the Science Museum, because they actually have a living example of one of his microscopes. This is a number 3 microscope. And you can all go and see it if you wish. You just have to send them your qualifications and, you know, write them a letter. And they have this, not in the not in the Science Museum itself, they have it in one of their archives. But they will allow you in, you know, with gloves and things, and you see I'm dissecting his microscope. And it was a great honor to be actually touching a Reif original microscope and dissecting it and understanding how it works. Needless to say, I do not understand how these work, because he defied the laws of physics and optics when he put these together. He's one of the leading geniuses, I would say, of the 20th and 21st century. It's a shame that a lot of his work is eradicated, but if someone's willing to put a million euros on the table, we can actually go back to and revisit his work, because a similar microscope to this is available now commercially, the Ergonom microscope from Dr. Albrick. And you know, that can see living viruses. We have this equipment. This equipment has been perfected now. So in terms of the electronics and producing the frequencies, that's done. All we need now is to sit under the microscope, you know, with a couple of microbiologists, to be able to find the resonant frequency of the individual viruses or bacteria or whatever. Once we've found the individual frequency, you can put it into a box that is much smaller than that. And then you have a little box for HPV, you have a little box for herpes, you have a little box for, you know, hepatitis, B and C, and so on and so forth. This is doable. It just needs some cash, because the microscope is about 240,000 euros, you know, plus the running expenses of the lab and the wages and what have you. This is the BICOM. This is a German technology. But this is a Bentley, if you like, because it's expensive. You know, I mean, we're maybe looking between 25 and 30,000 euros for that. So it's a Bentley, you know. But, you know, for the practitioner who wants to enter this field, you know, the Russian device downstairs is probably less than 7,000 sterling, yeah. It's a very powerful device because what this does is it picks up the pathological oscillatory frequencies from the patient themselves. So you don't have to understand the underlying causative factors because those pathological oscillatory frequencies contain all the pathological information which are present in all these underlying causative factors. And what it does is it passes it through electronic filters. It understands the difference between the normal sine wave, which is the normal electromagnetic field of the person, and the oscillatory spikes that may be present on the wave when there is pathology. And what it does is it inverts it. It inverts the pathological oscillatory frequencies. And when you get an inversion, you get a cancellation. I think it's the next slide. No. You get a cancellation. So it's cancelling out all the pathological oscillatory frequencies from the patient without you understanding the underlying causative factors. And it works beautifully for allergies. You can treat food intolerances. You can treat all sorts of allergies, neurodermatitis, asthma, and all sorts. It's a very powerful treatment. This is the PEPMI that I was telling you about, the pulsing electromagnetic device. Quite an expensive device. It was invented by Professor Pappas, who's a physicist, when he was at MIT with his mate doing in the States, doing some research on high voltage potentials. His mate was diagnosed with terminal cancer. So they said, well, you know, we're doing the research anyway, so let's leave a legacy behind us. You know, let's finish the research and, you know, who cares? So they carried on doing the research, and when they went back to Greece and his mate went into the clinic to get checked out, they found that he was completely free of cancer. And then they put their thinking caps on and they thought, what the hell's happening here? You know, could it be that these, you know, high voltage pulsing electromagnetic fields that, you know, we've been playing with could have actually treated me? And then they went back into the laboratory and they did further research using this type of technology that they'd put together on rats, and they were finding that tumors were actually disappearing from rats. And, you know, all sorts. And now it's used, you know, by a number of clinics around the world. These are some of the benefits. Anti-swelling, anti-inflammatory, unbelievable results. You know, you can heal burns in half the time or less. You can heal bones in half the time or less. When I was an equestrian and I fell off the horse, I broke my wrist. And they wanted to put plaster on it, but I couldn't work with plaster. So I said, no, let me do my own healing. And one of the healing things that I used, apart from soft laser and other things, was the PEPMI. I went back after 3 weeks and they x-rayed it again and it had completely healed. Completely healed. So all the inflammatory types of diseases, I've got in my book in the 15 case histories at the back, you know, there's a few patients that have actually used PEPMI. Hyperthermia, this is using microwave technology to heat up tissues, and you can heat up cancer cells or cancer tumors to 43.8 degrees centigrade, which completely destroys the enzyme systems and the cancer cell cannot reproduce and will die. But it does no harm to healthy tissues. So this disables intracellular repair enzymes that allow the cancer to survive radiation damage. Cells release heat shock proteins stimulating immunity, and it changes tissue perfusion, which allows, if you're using chemotherapy along with that, and a lot of oncologists are doing that now, they're finding that they need far less chemotherapy agents to have the same effect when they combine it with hypothermia. This is the ozone sauna we were talking about. This is the MRT. These are the benefits of the ozone sauna. Relaxes the muscles, reducing the buildup of lactic acid. It oxidizes the toxins, you know, that are eliminated through the detoxification organs. It boosts blood circulation, stimulates vasodilation, peripheral blood vessels, eliminates bacterial viral infections, and basically speeds up the metabolic processes of the inner organs and endocrine glands, resulting in a loss of 2 to 450 calories in a 20-minute session. We found by accident that if we do the ozone sauna and then the MRT, the matrix regeneration therapy with the bioresonance wheels, within a few, maybe 6 to 10 sessions, you can get rid of even intractable cellulite completely. It's gone. We found that, you know, when we were seeing some of the chronic patients that had a lot of cellulite, and we were treating them for other things, and then they were coming back and saying, hey, my cellulite's gone, you know, and then we thought, we're not treating your cellulite, and then we figured out that that's what was happening, because cellulite is no more than adipocyte cells, which are fat cells full of toxins that have actually, you know, enlarged. So if you can use this type of technology to get the toxins out of the cells, they shrink, they go back to normal, and the person is healthier. Infrared sauna is a good way of removing toxins that are fat soluble, and of course a lot of toxins are fat soluble. this is the orgone accumulator of Dr. Wilhelm Reich, which has layers, you see, of fiberglass and steel wool, which trap the orgone energy, so it acts as a conductor. The patient sits in there and they get passive orgone energy. But we've installed a foot bath as well, which is an ionizing foot bath, which actually draws out toxins from the soles of the feet. Now, when they tried selling this to me, I told them to piss off. I said, come on, you know, this, that. And then they commissioned me, because I had a toxicological laboratory, to actually test it for mercury, because they were having difficulties testing it for mercury. And here it is here. And when indeed I tested it for mercury, I found it was actually pulling mercury out of the soles of the feet. And then they sent me more data, you know, for other toxic metals like aluminium, cadmium, lead, you know, mercury, etc. Oh, mercury is the one they couldn't do. That's the one I did, you know, but there was more data on other heavy metals. And, you know, you see this type of difference. It's not the color of the water, because the color of the water can be created by the electrode itself. But this fatty type muck is just full of toxins. If I had a gas chromatography mass spectrometer, I would be testing, you know, these toxins, and I'm sure there'd be a lot of PCBs and bisphenol A's and, you know, other organic type chemicals. But once I did the research, you know, I was sold, and now we use it as standard as part of the Da Vinci Universal therapy protocols. Tachyon energy, I'm not going to get into the subject of tachyon, because this is a big topic. It's the interface between the energy of creation and the physical body.